20 minutes. Okay. Thank you, Mark. So it's a great pleasure for me to be here today. So I would like to thank the organizer of the symposium for the invitation. So it's a great pleasure to talk about the determinants of allergenicity and modulation of allergy, the rationale for perinatal intervention, and I will give you an example of prebiotic supplementation during perinatal period to prevent allergies. As you know, allergies are a real public health problem. They are classified as the fourth world disease according to the World Health Organization. They are the most common and the earliest manifestation of the vulnerability of the immune system to the modern environment. And currently, approximately 30% of the world population is affected by an allergy. And up to now, there has been no cure and no effective preventive strategy for this pathology. We can account three different types of allergies. First, the atopic dermatitis. This is a chronic disease with a worldwide prevalence rate of 1 to 20%. This is the most common allergic disease appearing in early life. It corresponds to pruritic inflammatory skin lesion associated with dry skin. Then, respiratory allergies. They are the most common allergies observed in Western countries, and it affects around 20% of the European population. And the symptoms are asthma, rhinitis, or rhinosinusitis. And finally, food allergy. Its prevalence in Europe is approximately 5.9%, especially 4.7% in the pediatric population and 3.2% in the adult one. The food allergy are various clinical symptoms at systemic level, the anaphylaxis, but at skin, respiratory, and gut level. The mechanisms of allergy are linked to the dysfunction of biological mechanisms, such as the microbiota, the epithelial barrier, and the immune system. Let's speak about the microbiota. As you know, the microbiota play a critical role for the homeostasis of our organisms. It's a complex microbial ecosystem composed of a majority of bacteria. It contains 10 power 14 cells, so it's more than the total of human cells. It can colonize nose, eyes, throat, gastrointestinal tract, or skin. Its composition can evolve all over the life. It is implanted at birth for contact with the mother, perineal and vaginal microbiota, and it can be modified by our environment, especially diet, antibiotics, infection. It is unique to each individual and can be tolerated by your immune system. And it plays a crucial role in immunomodulation, especially in oral tolerance, but also in gut barrier maturation. And when your microbiota is balanced, we talk about abiosis, and it has a positive effect on health. But sometimes, because of diet, because of antibiotics, there is a deviation, the dysregulation of your microbiota, and we talk about dysbiosis. And there is induction, in this case, of inflammatory phenomena related to your immune system, such as allergies. Now let's talk about the epithelial barrier. The epithelial barrier plays also a crucial role to protect the organisms against pathogens. It's a real defenses barrier composed of polarized cells connected by tight junction to ensure sealing. It can secrete molecules to have an antibacterial defense property, especially mucin, antimicrobial peptide, or enzyme. This mucosa is associated to a complex immune system called the MALF for mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue. And this immune system is composed of adaptive and innate cells that play a crucial role in the defense, but also in the oral tolerance, especially by the secretion of IgA that are secreted in relation to an optimal microbiota. But sometimes again, because of environment, there is a dysfunction, an alteration of your mucosa, and in this case, an increase of the permeability and a defect in immune tolerance as a result of a pathology such as, again, allergies. Allergies are also linked to immune system mechanisms. So I would like to describe the immune system in the context of allergy. So during the first phase, called the sensitization phase, the allergen arrive through the epithelial barrier, so the skin, the gut, or the lung barrier. And the allergen can be captured by a dendritic cell via dendritic extension or via epithelial cells. Then, the dendritic cells migrate to the lymph node to present allergen peptides to naive CD4 T cells, which can get differentiated in three different populations. The T regulatory cells involved in oral tolerance, the Th1 cells involved in anti-pathogen defense, and the Th2 cells involved in anti-parasite defense and in allergies. Then, differentiated T cells migrate to the spleen through the bloodstream, and there is an inhibition of Th1 and Th2, and this mechanism is called the Th2-Th1 balance that is regulated by T regulatory cells. But in the case of allergy, this balance is broken, and there is an overstimulation of Th2 cells and an overproduction of IL-4 by B cells differentiated in plasma cells. And these IgE are able to bind their receptor on the surface of mast cell. But at this stage, there is no clinical symptoms. This is the sensitization and the production of IgE. During a second contact with the same allergen, the allergen is fixed to the receptor of the mast cells, and there is a signal of degranulation, and the clinical symptoms appears. So, allergies are the most frequent and earliest manifestation of the vulnerability of the immune system, but also microbial mucosal system, related to, we think, to our modern environment. Indeed, we think that our modern environment lifestyles, including low fiber, high fat diet, too much hygiene, leads to a decline of microbial diversity and a disruption of mucosa and immune system maturation as a result of inflammatory diseases such as allergies. And these disorders are detectable at birth and they can cause inflammation. And we know that allergies are also detectable in the first months of life. So early life is a critical time for immune system disorders and for allergic risk, but it's also an opportunity to prevent from allergy. Indeed, we know that during perinatal period, so during pregnancy, delivery, and breastfeeding, there are exchanges of immune and bacterial factor between the fetus, the infant, and the mother. And we know that it's possible to modulate the immune system and the microbiota of the newborn in this period. We think also that the environment in both pregnancy and early childhood can determine physiologic, immune, metabolic, and bacterial development, which will influence future disease susceptibility. So it seems very interesting to study the early effect of lifestyle intervention, especially nutritional strategy on immune function and allergic disease. So all nutrients able to modulate microbiota and immune system seems very attractive for allergy prevention. And we can list different nutritional strategies with human milk oligosaccharides, probiotics, omega-3, vitamin D, the window of food introduction in newborn, and the prebiotics. I will focus the rest of my presentation on prebiotics because my expertise is in this scientific area. So prebiotics are by definition a non-digestible food ingredient which stimulates selectively the growth of bacteria in the microbiota, supposed beneficial for the whole health. And the main prebiotics are galactosaccharides, fructooligosaccharides, inulin, and they are found in chicory, artichoke, grain, or banana. We can find also prebiotics in breast milk, and we call of human milk oligosaccharides, and they play a crucial role for the maturation of the gut and the immune system. The prebiotics can have an effect on immune system and gut barrier by two effects. A direct effect, indeed, they can fix MAMP receptor on the surface of immune and epithelial cell or lectin, but they can act also by an indirect effect via the microbiota because they are fermented by microbiota and they induce the secretion of single-chain fatty acid that have epigenetic property and able to activate immune system and epithelial cells. So by this effect, prebiotics have the capacity to strengthen intestinal barrier and immune system to reduce infection risk, and they have a potential effect on allergies. So because prebiotics are able to modulate microbiota and immune system, and we know that allergies are linked to the dysfunction of these two systems, prebiotics are attractive for allergy prevention. And we can find two different strategies of prebiotic supplementation. During postnatal period, and we can list approximately 10 animal studies and two human studies and one meta-analysis. Prebiotics can be used also during perinatal period. We can list only 4 animal studies. And up to now, there is no published clinical trial during perinatal period, but only 2 ongoing human studies. I will speak about them after. Let's speak about postnatal strategy. Most animal studies have used prebiotic during a postnatal period. Especially in these studies, uterus used PEP from 3 to 8 weeks old, and they were supplemented during 2 or 3 weeks before sensitization to the allergen. In a first example of skin allergy, the prebiotic force were able to decrease the skin and inflammation. And this decrease of inflammation at the skin level was associated with a modulation of the microbiota, especially an increase of bifidobacteria. In a second example of respiratory allergy, the mixture of GOS, FOS, and pectin prebiotics were able to decrease the airway hyper-responsiveness, and it was associated with a decrease of specific IgE and a decrease of pulmonary inflammation. We can only find 2 favorable clinical trials. The first clinical trial is by the Moro team, and they use a mixture of GOS inulin at a ratio 9:1 in hydrolyzed milk formula, and this formula were given to children, infants at high risk of atopy during 6 months lactation, and they observe in this case a decrease of allergies at 6 months, but also at 24 months of age. In the second study of Gruber, they use the mixture of GOS inulin and pectin in infants at low risk of allergy during 6 months lactation. This is a multicenter study in 5 European countries, and they observe a decrease of atopic dermatitis at 1 year of age, but not at 5 years of age. So the preventive effect of the prebiotic was not able to persist over the time. In the meta-analysis of 4 studies on 1,428 infants at high or no risk of allergy, we observed in 2 studies no significant effect of the prebiotics in infant asthma. 4 studies demonstrated a significant reduction of eczema, and there is no effect in urticaria. This meta-analysis concludes to an heterogeneity of the studies. Indeed, the type of prebiotics, the period, the dose were not the same in all the clinical trials. So it was very difficult to conclude about the effect of prebiotics. So further research is needed before routine use of prebiotic can be recommended for prevention of allergy in formula-fed infants. That's why perinatal period seems very interesting. And we can list only 4 studies using a prebiotic in mother in animal models. In the first example of the Hogenkamp team, they use the prebiotics FOS and GOS during gestation in a context of respiratory allergy, and they observe a decrease of airway hyperresponsiveness associated with an increase of T regulatory cells at systemic level. In our study, we use a mixture of GOS inulin at a ratio of 9 per 1 during gestation and lactation in the context of food allergy to wheat. And we observe a decrease of clinical symptoms of food allergy, especially a decrease of temperature variation, a decrease of clinical score, a decrease of histamine secretion. And this decrease at clinic level was associated with a decrease of biomarker at immune level, especially a decrease of specific IgE and a decrease of Th2 cells. So diet enriched in GOS inulin prebiotics during gestation and lactation protects against food allergy in mice. So these studies were very interesting and encouraged to perform clinical trial in women. That's why currently we are developing 2 clinical trials to assess the effect of prebiotic during perinatal period on the prevention of allergy in the children at 1 year of age. These 2 studies are SIMBA and PREGRAL. In the one hand, SIMBA is performed in Australia, and in SIMBA, mothers are supplemented with the mixture of GOS inulin at a ratio of 9 per 1 during pregnancy and breastfeeding. And in the PREGRAL trial, the mothers are supplemented during only pregnancy, and we check in these 2 studies at 1 year of age, the eczema and the atopic dermatitis in child. In the SIMBA clinical trial, we would like to recruit 652 pregnant women whose infants have a first degree relative with a history of medically diagnosed allergic disease. So these women will be randomized in 2 groups, a placebo group and a prebiotics group. They will be supplemented, at 20 weeks of gestation until 6 months of lactation. And women are followed up during 6 months lactation, and children are followed up until 1 year of age. And the main site for recruitment, randomization, and follow-up is the Joondalup Health Campus in Perth in Australia, and the main academic coordinating center is the Teletong Kids Institute. And the SIMBA started in June last year. In June 2016, not last year. We are in 2018. So let's speak about PREGRAL clinical trial. In this trial, we would like to recruit 376 allergic pregnant women. They will be also randomized in 2 groups, but they will be supplemented with the prebiotic between 20 weeks gestation until delivery. The main site for the recruitment and follow-up are the Nantes, Angers and Tours Hospital. It's a multi-center trial. And the coordinating center is a center of clinical investigation for women, children and teens in Nantes. In Simba and Pregral, the objectives are finally the same. We want to assess the effect of the prebiotic intervention on allergic disease outcome in children at 1 year of age, especially eczema in Simba and atopic dermatitis in Pregral. We want to check the colonization pattern and the function of the microbiota by the secretion of single chain fatty acid in both the mother but also the children. We want also to assess the immunomodulatory effect of prebiotics in mother but also in offspring, both at birth and during infancy, to examine the trajectory of immune development. So we will check innate cells, but also adaptive cells. And especially in Pregral, we will analyze the composition of breast milk, especially nutrients, immune factor, and carbohydrates. Finally, by Simba and Pregral study, we hope to obtain results, that's true, for the future to demonstrate the interest of prebiotics to prevent allergy via two clinical trials run in two very different countries. We want to define the most effective timing and duration of maternal prebiotic supplementation. Is it necessary to supplement during gestation only? Wouldn't it be better to supplement during lactation also? We want also to demonstrate the importance of microbiota and immune system balance early in early life in correlation with the emergence of allergic disease. So I would like to conclude by the thing that I have demonstrated that allergy are linked to microbial, mucosal, and immune system disorders. And we know that all these systems are developed during early life. So the perinatal period is a critical window for the modulation of these systems and for the modulation and the prevention of allergy. And with the example of prebiotic, I have demonstrated that nutritional strategies, especially in early life, are very encouraging concerning the allergy prevention. So I would like to thank my team in France, my collaborator in France, especially Sébastien Barbaro, the coordinator of the Pregral Triad. And I would like also to thank my collaborator in Australia, especially Suzanne Prescott and Debbie Palmer, especially I spent 1 year in their lab in 2016 to follow the Simba trial. So I would like to thank for your attention. Thank you.